So most of you would have guessed that tune. It is from the movie Sound of Music, or at least it is, that's where it starts. Favorite things, right? So now what is the favorite things besides the movie Sound of Music? Now it has a very interesting history. The original song was written by Rodgers and Hammerstein, and then in a couple of decades it found its way into the world of jazz, where it was picked by this great musician named John Coltrane. And Coltrane completely changed the way the song was staged, interpreted, improvised. So when you talk about how are patterns present in music, that's like asking, you know, where are the patterns in mathematics? Mathematics is a study of patterns. Similarly, music is a study of patterns. Specifically with this song though, if you look at what's going on, this is a score, right? What is apparent is if you listen to it the first time, you will start seeing some of these patterns one by one. With every listening, you'll get a little extra. So at the end of five or a few listenings, you would have picked up many of the things that I call forms, which are on this side of the slide. So these forms are essentially the way in which music is coded, whether it is Indian music or American, whether it's Western or any other form. There are certain things to music that are present, which you observe on the right. Now, music's ability goes well beyond just the study of these patterns, these small patterns. They lead to larger patterns, the patterns that we can recognize as personal, social. So enter, if this works, all right. Right, so these are what I call the transforms of music. So when you have a piece like Favorite Things played as a jazz interpretation, there are certain things that are hiding in the song itself. These are also patterns. They're waiting to be discovered not on the fifth or the tenth time that you listen to it, but on the 50th time, the 100th time. There is something more to the music that automatically draws you towards, forces you to dig through it, and then it reveals patterns such as the faith that the music represents, the inner struggle of the musician, the trance that the performance induces, the Indian ragas that seem to come enter in and out of the performance. I mean the performance by Coltrane, not just by an Indian musician like me. The roots of the type of music, the African roots, the roots in blues, the roots. And then how does it unite? What is the emotion that it produces in you? These, I would say, are the deeply personal impact that a great piece of music is capable of producing. So from the world of jazz, I want to generalize a bit. And if you take any song, you can basically break it down. Like, we are IITians, this is what we have done day in and out. We take a huge complex problem and then we start carving it out. We take little bits and pieces of it. And this is my instinct too, and I thought today I would focus on a couple of things of interest. Now, mind it, this is all connected. There is no way that I can just discuss about lyrics and not talk about rhythm. There is no way that music, a discussion on music is complete without talking about melody. But for the purposes of this presentation, I wanted to focus on a couple of things. The modes, what we call as ragas, and the lyrics, what we call as sahitya. Now, when it comes to the notes, these are the building blocks of music. Some of you would have recognized that I'm suggesting a pattern right here. Like, on the top of the slide, there is already a pattern. It is the famous additive series, which is 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, and so on. So, you know what the series is? Yes, Harichandra, Hemachandra series, Fibonacci series. There are many names over the centuries that it's been called. Now, if you look at the way in which the notes are arranged in a keyboard, there is something that is strongly suggestive of the Fibonacci series in it. The two black keys, the three other black keys, together the five black keys, and then the eight white keys, which is the next number in the sequence, together, which is the 13 keys, together in a sequence or an octave. These are all not by accident, because a lot of this also has to do with the way in which we perceive musical notes. In the way in which our ears perceive notes is logarithmic. And so it is understood that we can divide an octave into 12, arrange the notes as a logarithmic series, and thus discover after the fact that, hey, there is a really interesting series that's happening here. There's a pattern in this too. So now that we have 12 notes in an octave, or 13 to complete the octave, what are the various things that we can do with it? So one way to explore the notes in an octave is the way in which the Indian raga system has done. Methodically, taken the 12 notes in an octave and generated 72 ragas out of this. Does anybody know this sort of system of generation? Do you know what it is called? Yes, thank you. Melakarta. So you see, there is this circle naturally looks like a mandala or a pattern. It's a manifestation of certain permutations on combinations, some of which are allowed, some of which are disallowed, creating two sides of 36 ragas each, right? So from the world of modes, we have jumped to the world of ragas. And what is it that distinguishes or differentiates a mere collection of notes from a feeling or an emotion? That's what raga really means, right? Raga means emotion, right? So here we have a system of deriving ragas using a simple algorithm, again, pattern, right? Now, I wanted to demonstrate one such raga and link it with a very oft repeated pattern in lyrics in poetry, especially in Indian poetry. And you can see this happen over and over again, especially in Sanskrit. It's called yati. Yati is a way in which you can arrange notes, arrange words in a descending or ascending order in a way that is pleasing, that is meaningful, and that befits the theme in question. So that brings me to one of the greats of Carnatic music. I'm going to give a quick summary of what hides behind this. The two lyrical patterns. The song is set in the raga Ananda Bhairavi. Sa pa sa. Na 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 na. Yoga Vaibhavam Agaraja Yoga Vaibhavam Raja Yoga Vaibhavam Yoga Vaibhavam Vaivavam Bavam Vam Tyag Raj Yoga Vaivavam. You see how in the Pallavi itself, thank you, there is a beautiful cascading but also a narrowing. This is a gopucha, like a cow's tail. In the very same song, in the very next stanza, Muduswami Dikshitar introduces the opposite pattern, which is the widening, like the mouth of a river. Shrota Vaha.
Shri Guru Guha Gurum Sachidananda Bhai Ravisham Shiva Saktyadi Sakalatva Swarupa Prakasham Sam Prakasham Swarupa Prakasham Tattva Swarupa Prakasam Sakala Tattva Swarupa Prakasam Shiva Saktyadi Sakala Tattva Swarupa Prakasam Tyaga Raja Yoga Vaibhavam.
Thank you. So here the music combines with the lyric to present a very uplifting and interesting pattern. Now from here I wanted to jump very quickly and very briefly into the world of coding. So I started off saying that music is like math. Music is math in many ways. And this is a very interesting example of a music or a composition that seems to be endlessly on an ascent or a descent. Right? So it's called a shepherd's stone, and it is a very simple algorithm to actually be able to code this, and I have done that as a live demo. So here you have this endless stair. Do you know what, does anybody know who was the artist behind these kind of wacky ideas? Yes, sure, thank you. And I remember having been completely boggled by this picture. We had a book of this in our wing at IIT. The pictures were the most mind-boggling. And after that came the music. And this is from the book itself. The music that is down there is from the book Godalesha Bach, where Douglas Hofstadter presents this idea of a shepherd's stone. When I read that book, I had absolutely no inkling of how to even code this or how do I even visualize this. This is the thing. You can see the pattern, but you can't hear it. So I have actually implemented it, and I'm going to play it really quickly for you. Does it feel endless? As if it is always rising and rising? It really is not. There are basically three strands of music that are playing simultaneously. Music or notes or sounds. And each one of them has a different amplitude characteristic. All you do is tweak the loudness, but you do it dynamically. On one strand, you keep increasing the amplitude. On the middle strand, you don't change anything. And then on the lower stand, you decrease. And our ears basically connect the increase to the decrease transition as something that is continuous. And what we end up feeling and perceiving is this constant ascent of sound, as if there is no end to it. This is exactly the endless staircase in audio form. If anybody wants to know about the code, come and talk to me later. Thank you. For the sake of time, I'm going to skip to my last portion. And this is again very personal. Personally, I find this music extremely, extremely lilting. There are two reasons for it. One is because one part of that music was tuned by my own mentor, Dr. Balamurali Krishna, and the other by me. So I feel strong ownership towards the music, but the lyric itself is something that's quite incomparable. There is very few instances of literature that can possibly hold a candle to what you see on the board here. And these are two songs out of a series of songs. It is written by Tirujnana Sammandar, a Shaivite poet. What he has done is he has created a giant palindrome. Okay, the song is a palindrome line after line. The second line is the reverse of the first line. And thus has he composed this padigams, this prayers, offerings to Shiva. So mind-boggling. And the tune that accompanies this is also a palindrome. So I'm going to present to you the last pattern of my program, Malai Matral. Malai Matral, you exchange garlands. It's the same garland, but there are two sides to it. So.
Ya mama ni ya mama, ya ri ka ma ka na ka. Kana kama kariya mama yani mama ya ya ka ya I ka ya ka ta ya ra ra da ya 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 da ra ra ya Rakarami daya sarida ye nani la yuriga kari yula nina ye nina ye tari saya tamra karane tari saya tamra karane tari saya tamra karane
about all I had to say. I think, you know, this is a life's quest for me, discovering musical patterns, just discovering new music, and then realizing that there is so much linkage with music and everything else, with musics of the world, with music and life. So I'm glad you were here for me to present to. And that's not all. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I request Mr. Vishwanath Kumpala, an alumnus of IIT Madras and a generous benefactor of IIT.